Spirit calls. good morning. Woo! You guys ready to go? Because that song has got me going. I'm going to switch guitars. Here you go. Thank you, Stacy. This week was a very exciting week for me. I got to help move Ryan Parker up to Charlotte, North Carolina. And it is a sad thing to see him go, but it is so excited to see just what life's going to bring him. And he'll always be coming back and forth and playing drums, I'm sure. And but one of the exciting things on the way back, we got to see the image of the CD release or the song release of Lean In. It came out Friday. So if you haven't already downloaded it and shared it with your friends and family, do so, because it's a song we're really, really proud about. And there was many hands in this song, and it couldn't have been the same without just our community putting a little bit of their fingerprint on it. And so we're proud of it. Share it. And we got a couple more for you this morning. You guys ready? All right. Thanks.
Thank you. Pursue, and I will pursue. Morning, Suncoast. Man, if that doesn't get your blood going, I don't know what will. I'm Dr. Troy Doucet, one of the teaching pastors here at Suncoast. Thanks for joining us, whether you're here live in person or watching via one of our live streams online. Thanks. We are in week four of a series we have called At the Movies. Hasn't this band killed the theme songs from these movies? Like, just unreal, unbelievable. Some of you are like, well, this is really church? Is this church? Heck yeah, this is church. This is how we throw down. And in fact, we're going to have a little bit of fun. Remember, week one was Top Gun. We talked about how does God speak to us in our modern day. Week two, Back to the Future. We talked about how we shouldn't be anxious or worry about our future because God is always going before us. And how many guys remember last week? How many guys were blessed by Tristan's testimony last week? That it doesn't matter your past, when I come to realize and recognize who I am and whose I am, man, God makes a way where there is no way. And today, we get to look at one of the most motivational and inspirational film franchises, in my opinion, the Rocky franchise. It's close to my heart because not many people know this. I used to box. I boxed for 4 years, man. Brett, I was a boss, dude. Don't mess with me, man. You know, that it's just an incredible series. It's all about the underdog, overcoming adversity, right? I love one of the quotes Rocky does all the time. He says, a champion is really just a contender that never gave up, that always persevered. But today I'm going to focus on a different side of the story. It's what do we do? How is Jesus a model for us when we go through adversity and difficulty in our life? What can we learn from Jesus' own difficulty? But before we do that, I want to have a little bit of fun. We do church a little bit differently, and this movies thing has gotten me, I love movies. I love going to the movies. In fact, we have a gift card to any movie theater you want. It's a Fandango card. You need to get out your cell phones right now. Get your phones out, and we're going to play a little bit of movie trivia, Suncoast movie trivia, based upon the four movies we watched, right? We've learned from Top Gun, Back to the Future, Lion King, and Rocky. So they're going to put it up. You'll go to Kahoot.it, type in this PIN number, put in your name, or it'll assign you a name, and we're going to go, when we hit right around 30 people, we are going to rock and roll for time, all right? So sign up, Kahoot.it, type in the PIN, and we'll play some movie trivia before we jump into this sermon. Got our game show music going. All right, a few more people, then we'll get it going. All right, I have eight questions. Eight questions, two from each movie. You have about 10 seconds to choose the correct answer, but it's not just based upon correct answers. It's based upon how fast you can get that correct answer from your phone. All right, guys, we're ready to crank it up. Here we go. Question number one, coming from Top Gun. Here's the question. Who played Iceman? Who was the actor who played Iceman in Top Gun? Val Kilmer. That's right. Polite Panther. Way to go. What is the fighter jet known as in Top Gun? Which one of these is the fighting jet that the Navy has retired but was used for all of the jet fights in Top Gun? Which one was it? The F-14 Tomcat. That's right. Now we're on to Back to the Future. How much power does Doc DeLorean's time machine need to get back to the future? Which one is it? gigawatts. There you go, not 121, 1.21. All right, who was the bully? Here's a tough one, a tough one. Who was the bully in Back to the Future? That's right, Biff Tannen, not Buff. Okay, what actor voiced Mufasa? He was also Darth Vader and Eddie Murphy's dad in Coming to America. James Earl Jones, that's right. All right, here's one you're gonna start singing. What does Hakuna Matata mean? It means for the rest of your days. No worries. Someone put Feed Me. Get popcorn immediately. All right, who's Clubber Lang in Rocky III? Famous guy, not the guy who bit the other guy's ear off. Not him. Give you a hint. He's got the mohawk. That was Mr. T. And the last one, a little bit difficult. What was the name of Rocky's trainer? His original trainer was who? Mickey! All right, let's see who our winner is. Our top three, number three goes to Polite Panther. Second place, Amazon Bobcat, and the winner, Silly Hawk. Where are you at, Silly Hawk? Where is Silly Hawk? Right down the middle. Come see Pastor Brett. Give it up. Woo! Great job, Ben. Good job, buddy. We know this guy. Awesome. Good job. So, you know, one of my things as a dad, man, I find being a father is a privilege and honor. I love my children. I have two daughters. My daughter's driving now. She's 16. She comes to Florida to visit us, and all she wants to do is take my Jeep out, right? That's all she wants to do, is take the Jeep. But as a dad, growing these kids, I have a responsibility, right? Because I feel my philosophy is that my children did not ask me to be here. I brought them into this world. And my philosophy is, since I made that decision to bring them to life, to bring them into this world, I owe them everything. I owe them everything. I owe them provision. I owe them protection. Right? I protect them up to a certain age, and I will probably provide for them until the day I'm freaking dead, right? Like, that's just part of it. But one of my objectives is this, is that I want my children to be raised to be strong and brave. And what is the value of strength? Every culture you ever read about in civilization has valued strength and bravery. Why is that? Why do we not, like, erect monuments to cowards? because our culture knows that strength is a necessary virtue in our life. Why? So we can oppress and marginalize people and overpower people? No. Strength is a value because we know that adversity and difficulty is going to come. It's not a question of if, it's a question of what? When. How many of you guys have walked through some difficult times in your life that you did not expect to have to go through? Yeah, me too. And this is why strength is such a value, is that we want to raise up a generation of people to be strong so that when adversity hits, we can walk through it with courage and bravery. And our story, your story, becomes the inspiration and a motivation for others to see, especially when I give God the glory, especially when people see me going through a trial and I just shine the light on God. And I say, God is helping me through this, because on my own strength, it would be impossible to do. And that's the idea. But yet we live in a culture that we have a new word, a new sociological term called helicopter parenting. Anybody ever heard of that before? Helicopter parenting is when I try to keep my children out of harm's way of pain or disappointment. When in fact, we know this. As humans, we are walking paradoxes, right? I believe theologically, philosophically, you were made for one reason, to love, to give and receive love. Why? Because God is love. But yet the paradox of that is, how does love become so rich and meaningful to us? Most of the time, oftentimes, I come to value love more when I have to go through difficult times. It's as though love becomes sort of like illuminated as I get it when I'm walking through tough times. How many of you guys are thankful that you had someone to love you through a difficult time in your life? Man, me too. And that's the paradox. If all we had was love and no difficulty, man, we would take love for granted, right? Like, my wife and I always struggle. Like, we're like, how do people who are local to Sarasota not go to the beach? Like, I have no idea. Why? Because you take it for granted, right? If I'm just speaking plain, oh, the beach. Locals don't do that. I'm local now, and I'm changing that mindset, dude. I love that place. But yet, what we want to see is that suffering is going to be a part of our life, and suffering can illuminate God's love and purpose in our life. But we have to be strong, and we have to be courageous, because it's not a question of if, but when. And like the old saying says, right, if you're going through hell, what? Keep going. And God will give you the strength to do that. I want to watch this clip real quick from Rocky. It's from 2006's Rocky Balboa. And Rocky is speaking to his son about the truth, about the reality of life, that it's not all about sunshine and rainbows, that life will hit you where it hurts, and life will keep you down if you let it. So let's watch this clip. Check it out.
Let me tell you something you already know. The world ain't all sunshine and rainbows. It's a very mean and nasty place, and I don't care how tough you are, it will beat you to your knees and keep you there permanently if you let it. You, me, or nobody is gonna hit as hard as life. But it ain't about how hard you hit. It's about how hard you can get hit and keep moving forward, how much you can take and keep moving forward. That's how winning is done. Now, if you know what you're worth, now go out and get what you're worth. But you got to be willing to take the hits and not pointing fingers saying you ain't where you want to be because of him or her or anybody. Cowards do that, and that ain't you. You're better than that.
Woo, man. I love that clip. It's motivational, but I want to tie some theological principles into that. I want us to look at this. I want you to examine this container as like your life in the early part of your life, growing up, right? Being raised by nurturing parents. And in this container, I want to call this container the container of yourself, right? Because your parents pour things that are absolutely important into your life early on. So I'll use my popcorn. They pour things into you like traditions. Like, we go to church on Sundays. We eat fried turkey on Thanksgiving, right? You have all these traditions that you and your family keep, whatever they are. But then they also teach you like social customs, right? Certain societal customs like, hey, when I tell my son this all the time, I go, when you meet someone, you shake their hand and you what? Look them in the eyes, right? You wear a ring on your ring finger if you're married, right? That's sort of like a social custom. But we also teach certain ideas of authority, right? Respect your elders, right? Respect policemen. Policemen don't dress the same as us, right? You know them in public. They don't have the same cars, right? You could be doing the speed limit, like being a good model citizen doing a speed limit. But if you see a policeman parked in the median, what do? You still tap that brake, right? Yeah. We'll talk about psychology later. But you get these ideas of authority, spiritual authority. Respect your pastor, your teachers. How many of you guys ever met your teacher in Walmart? Awkward as all get out, right? I remember one time I was in Kroger back in Dallas, and I was barbecuing for some friends. And here I am looking at, you know, all the assortment of craft beers. And I just hear, Dr. Doucet? Hey, Joe, what's up? What are you doing here? He was a student in my philosophy class. I was like, well, you know, Colin College lets me out of my cage from the campus on occasion to drink beer and barbecue. It's like an awkward situation. But we're taught that, and then we're also taught principles of like morality. Don't hit your sister. Don't bite, right? Be good. Share your toys. And this helps us because if you don't have this container of yourself, things could go really bad for you later in life, right? But then something happens. This container represents for all of our life a type of certainty, a type of solidarity, a type of continuity, a type of predictability, right? I should always do this. We've always done it this way. I should always respect that person. This person would never hurt me. But then what happens? As we get older, something will take place in your life that hits this container and begins to make you question the certainty of that principle you were taught. It could be anything. For me, it was when my grandfather got Alzheimer's disease. I was a very, very more conservative, fundamentalist Christian. I believed that God healed. We just needed to have enough faith. We needed to pray. We needed to fast. And here's the man that I love the most. Seeing him deteriorate mentally hit my container, almost shattered that idea of God. It didn't change who God was. I had to change my idea of what I believed God was. That's the idea here. And Jesus himself would have had this container, something very similar to what you and I have. He went to synagogue with his family. He learned and memorized the Torah. He had his own ideas of what were just and unjust ideas and notions in his culture. And even Jesus challenged everyone that he came across their container of certainty and predictability. But when struggle happens, when difficulty happens and hits our container, could it be, I will never say that God is the one who brings suffering, who brings adversity, but I will say this, God will always use suffering and use adversity to do what? To see you become more like him. And the real question is this that I want to ask you guys today. Are there things in your container, I want to call this your comfort zone container, are there things you still hold on to that prevents you from going to the places where God is calling you to go? Because in this container is safety, security, certainty. But sometimes God's spirit calls, just like that first song we sang. If your spirit's calling, I'm coming. And a lot of times God will use adversity to take us out of that comfort zone container and into areas where risk and danger lie. But the certainty is that what? God will always be there with me. Grow strong. And like Rocky said, I love that clip. Rocky says, life will beat you down and keep you down. And there are many people I come across as a pastor in my life where life has beat them down and they stay down, not because they're weak, but because they refuse to change certain ideas about their container of comfort. God always wants to renew our mind, but we're always tested. We're always tempted to do a few things, to remain the same, to keep the same beliefs and opinions, to keep the same mindset. We're always tempted to hold on to this container so tightly when God is like, let it go, trust me, Follow me into the unknown, where risk is there, but so am I, and you will grow like you've never grown before. Because it's here that we can experience like the life-changing power of God. So if you feel that you're not growing in your faith or your faithfulness, I want to challenge you. Check your container. Check that container. We are going to be tested. We are going to face adversity. And it's up to us to step out into the unknown, to trust the Spirit of God, even when risk is a better quality than safety, because I know God may be the one calling me. Because let me, I don't want to get this wrong. God loves you exactly where you are, but God also loves you way too much for you to stay there. That's what I want to tell you. He loves you exactly where you are, but way too much for you to stay there. Even Jesus faced testing and adversity. No test was as tough as the cross for Jesus. But even before he goes to accomplish a mission that he had set before him, there was an adversity that he had to be exposed to, and that was his temptation in the wilderness. I want us to read this verse from Matthew 4 together. Jesus has just been baptized, and the Spirit of God is beckoning him, calling him into the wilderness, which is always a place of isolation, desperation, and difficulty. Look at what the scripture says when Jesus is tested. Then Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tested by the devil. And after fasting 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry. And the tester came to him and said, "If you are the Son of God, tell these stones to become bread." But Jesus answered, "It is written, man shall not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God." Then the devil took him to the holy city, Jerusalem, and had him stand on the highest point of the temple. And he tells him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down. For it is written that God will command his angels concerning you, and they will lift you up into their hands so you will not strike your foot against a stone." And Jesus says, "Satan, it's also written, do not put the Lord your God to the test." And then finally, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world in their splendor. And he said, "I will give this to you if you would just bow down and worship me." And Jesus says what? "Away from me, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only." This is a very interesting text, because from it, we get this notion of Satan and the devil and so forth and so on. And many people believe that there is an actual entity named the devil or Satan. But the word in this text, devil, diabolos, is actually not a noun. It's not a person, it's not a place, it's not a thing. It's actually a type of cognitive action. Because the truth is, which is point number one I want to make if you're taking notes, is that any test you face in life may happen externally to you. You find out your spouse is leaving. You found out you have a doctor's report that you're sick. That may happen externally to you, but where does the fight take place? In your mind, in your spirit. It is going to happen internally. Even the word Satan, while that is a noun, the word in Greek is so ambiguous. Satan can take the form of any person, any place, or anything that opposes what you want to do in the name of God. Remember when Jesus is about to be taken, and he's like, "Yo, guys," he's telling his disciples, "they're going to come and grab me, they're going to take me and judge me, and then they're going to kill me." What does Peter do? Peter goes, "I will never let that happen." Peter is standing in the way of Jesus' mission. So what does Jesus say? "Get behind me, Peter." No, what does he say? "Get behind me, Satan." Satan could be your own thoughts keeping you from stepping out and trusting God. Satan is not the guy with the pitchfork and the pointy tail and the horns. That's like a cultural image. Satan is a force that is prevalent in the world that wants to keep you from doing and becoming all that God has for you. And sometimes Satan comes in the form of safety, security, when God is telling you, take a risk and trust me with everything you have. That's what it's all about, y'all. Listen to what the Stoic philosopher, I love this guy, his name's Seneca. He wrote this about facing adversity in life. He said, to bear trials of life with a calm mind will rob the misfortune of its strength over you, and it will lift the burden it has on your life. We know that Jesus' temptation in the wilderness was a mental sort of testing. We use the word tempt in that scripture, but Jesus wasn't tempted. Tempting means to what? Entice someone to do something wrong. Jesus was tested, not tempted. If he'd have turned those stones into bread, who cares? He's 40 days, 40 nights into not eating. Dude was hungry. But there's something within these testings that you and I can learn from when we face adversity. And the first one is this. The first temptation is to what? Turn stones into bread. How does that relate to you and I's life when we go through a testing or a difficult time? It's a question of provision. You might want to write that down. The first test we always face is, who is your provider? Who's really providing for your life? Because in this container, I know I was taught, you know who provides for you? You do. Get a job. Get an education. Work hard. And then you could have your dreams. How many of you guys were taught that? But then you get a doctor's report. Can't work. You're disabled. Something challenges the container of comfortability where you go, those types of provision no longer apply. They're no longer certain. I have to rely completely on God's provision. Your testing in trusting God will always question, who do you see as your source of provision? Who do you see? We live in a technological age where people find their source of meaning and identity by how many likes they get, how many comments they get, how many shares they get. Jesus is asking us, my first temptation, my first testing was, who's my provider? I can do it myself, but I can't live on bread alone. I can't live on man's provision alone. I can't rely totally on my intellect, my hard work. Sometimes when I go through difficult trials, I have to see God as my sole source and provider. My life is always going to drive in the direction of my strongest thoughts. And if the strongest thought I have right now is, God, you are my provision, that's a good place to start. Point number two, if you're taking notes, is this. Without opposition or difficulty in life, you will never know what you're capable of accomplishing. I believe we can only change for the better when we are truly challenged by the worst. You have inside of you right now, each one of you, incredible potential to face adversity and make it through. And it's through that adversity that others will see God in you and be inspired to make it through their own trials. Listen to what Seneca, the philosopher, says again. This is so true. Our true self is revealed, not hidden, in adversity and trials. So when trouble comes, think of yourself as a wrestler who God has put in training, placed in an arena with a very difficult adversary. Why would God do this, you ask? To turn you into what Seneca calls an Olympic caliber athlete. Like, that's so boss. What was the second temptation Jesus faced? Satan takes him to the highest point in Jerusalem, the holy city, on the temple where people would gather to worship. And he says, look down, Jesus, and jump. Because God says that if you jump, he's going to send angels, a legion of angels immediately to help you just kind of glide down so you don't even hurt your foot on a stone. You know what that temptation is, what that testing is? Satan is asking Jesus to perform. Put on a good performance. You're hungry. You're thirsty. You're dying of starvation. But God says, if you just jump, he's going to send angels. Like, how easy would it have been for people to trust Jesus as the Messiah if he's floating down from a cloud off of the temple? And guess what? Your testing will often come for you to perform as well. When your life's falling apart, you still post that what? That selfie. I call it sometimes taking a lonely. You know, you're just by yourself taking it. But there's a temptation for us to hide all of the junk and the tribulation we face and put on a performance. But here's what a performance will never do. Like, I get up here every Sunday when I preach, and I give my all in my sermon. I give everything. I could give an inspired sermon, an encouraging sermon, move you to tears, have a young boy give his testimony that just motivates you. And that would be the performance of a lifetime. But performance will never equate to perseverance. And Jesus knows, I can perform, but I need to persevere. Your testing will always be, I do not want to put a smile on. Because honestly, y'all, if I can't be real as a pastor about my own adversity and struggle, then how could I ever have the audacity to tell you what you should do with yours? Some of you right now are facing tough times in your life. You're walking through your own difficulty. And God will use that to ask you these same questions. Who's your provider? Are you just putting on a performance? But what about this last temptation? Well, I want to say this. Point three, life is hard, but God is good. And what is this last temptation where Satan takes him up to this highest point, this sort of imaginary point where he sees all of the kingdoms of the world, and he says, hey, dude, this could be yours if you just worship me. It's always a testing for me of position when suffering comes. Where does my positional power lie? Am I positioned to look to God, who tells me that even in my weakest state, he is the strongest? Or am I positioned back to my comfort zone container of safety and security? The power of tradition. This is how we've always done it. You want to know why religion is failing, why Christianity is dying in America? Because they're saying, this is how we've always done it. Am I going to rely on the power of authority? They're always right. No, guess what? I love my parents, but they actually got some things wrong. I'm a parent, and guess what? I'm an authority in my kids' life, and sometimes I have to go to my kids and say what? I'm sorry. Do I trust in the power of morality that you've been taught this is always wrong, black and white? Or do I put my position and point it towards a God who is there with me, walking with me, saying, I'm going to provide. You don't have to perform. Just position yourself to trust me. Take this risk with me. I'm with you always. Sickness, divorce, suffering, betrayal, being abused by people we love can challenge our core in a lot of ways, especially if we want to just try to hide and cover up pain. But I am thankful that we serve a God, y'all, that is in a constant state of letting us be challenged by this very question. Do you really trust me? Do you really trust me? Stand with me. Let me pray for you, Suncoast. What's in your container keeping you from positioning yourself to go God, to go with God and take great risk with great faith with him? You got to look inside. Who's providing? Are you putting on a performance, and are you positioned ready for that test? Because the tests are coming if they're not already here. Let me pray for you. God, I pray for my friends here at Suncoast that we would just be inspired to go and live for you, to step out of our comfort zone container and to trust you to lead us, to provide, because you are the God who is the God of provision. And God, you will never send us where you have not gone and where you will not be. So let us have that great faith and faithfulness today. In Christ's name, amen. See you guys, Suncoast. Have a good one.